A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin was salatu was salamu ala ashrafi khalqillahi Muhammad wa alihi at-tayyibin at-tahirin. We know that in Islam knowledge is very, very important. We know that there's a very strong emphasis on pursuing knowledge, seeking knowledge, gaining as much knowledge as we can, especially when the knowledge is beneficial, especially when the knowledge is going to give you proximity and closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are so many hadith that we know off by heart. Seek knowledge from your cradle till your grave. Seek knowledge even if you have to travel to China. We know the word iqra is the first word descended by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unto the Holy Prophet as the first word in the Quran. And the holy book of Islam is something that there is that frequent theme of knowledge and seeking of knowledge that can be seen throughout it. And we also understand that those who hold knowledge, those who represent the seeking of knowledge, are also valued in Islam, or al-ulama. And of course, ilm and the value of ilm is very important, and the bearers of ilm also hold a very high status in Islam. We as Muslims must respect knowledge. We must also respect those who bear knowledge, especially when that knowledge is going to remind you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially when that knowledge or the bearer of knowledge is going to gain you a better akhirah. And this is exactly why Imam Ali alayhi salam, he divides people into three categories. The first is alimun rabbani. And when he says alimun rabbani, he means that a alim that has, that carries the good positive qualities of what a alim truly needs to be. And we're not talking about someone who carries knowledge but doesn't do or practice what it is that they know. You know, that's not in any way close to what our discussion is focused on. Although I'm going to be mentioning those kind of people who have knowledge but is of no use. As the Quran says, كَالْحِمَارِ يَحْمِلُ أَسْفَارًا. Of, there's no benefit, you know, الْعَالِمُ بِلَا عَمَلْ كَالْشَجَرِ بِلَا ثَمَرْ. As the hadith says, a alim that doesn't have a amal to support it, that doesn't act upon it, is like a barren tree, a tree that is of no use. It doesn't bear any fruit, doesn't give any shade, it's of no use. But in principle, we understand as Muslims that there needs to be that high level of reverence and honor and respect to the alim, the bearer of knowledge, someone who has taken it upon himself, upon herself, to represent the most important thing that we have as human beings. What allows a society, a civilization to progress and advance? It's ilm. What gives you cultural value? What solves your social problems? What allows you to have that level of independence and honor and everything else? It's, of course, ilm and the seeking of knowledge. And that's why the second category that Imam Ali says after Alimun Rabbani is Muta'allimun ala sabilil najat, someone who is pursuing knowledge in the path of attaining, or for the sake of attaining, salvation. And the third is the rest, like cattle, a herd of cattle, hamajun ru'a, which is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inshaAllah will keep us away from. Speaking about the value of knowledge and the value of the bearer of knowledge, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi, he says, فَضْلُ الْعَالِمِ عَلَى الْعَابِدِ. You know, we have someone who is an ascetic person, very devotional, Aabid, worshipping all the time, but doesn't have a ilm. He's doing it, doing the rituals of religion, which is a very, very good thing, but not better than gaining knowledge, not better than talabul ilm and seeking knowledge. The virtue of a knowledgeable person over a worshipping person is like the virtue of the moon over the rest of the stars, Laylat al-Badr, when it is a full moon. A full moon is the full moon over the rest of stars. That's the comparison between the virtue of a knowledgeable person over a abid person. Even more than that, when we can see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned in the Holy Quran, هَلْ يَسْتَوِ الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ إِنَّمَا يَتَذَكَّرُوا أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. There's no equal comparison between one who knows and one who does not know. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given virtue over the knowledgeable in the hadith where Jibra'il was asked about the virtue, the status of Al-Alim, and he said, Al-Alimul Wahid Akramu ala Allah. One Alim is more honored by God min alfi shaheeds, more honored than 1,000 martyrs. Fa'inna iqtida'u al-ulama bil-anbiya, because the ulama follow, they emulate the anbiya, and wa iqtida'u shuhada'i bil ulama, and the martyrs they follow or pursue, they emulate the ulama, which is exactly why, you know, when you find that kind of alimun rabbani, someone who reminds you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, someone who reminds you of akhirah, someone who, where you look at, you feel empowered, you feel strong, you feel motivated, you feel spiritual, you feel religious. At least during that time that you are with them, you have that sense of strength when it comes to your religious conviction, which is exactly why al-nadharu ila wajhi al-alimi ibadah, as the hadith says from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi. Another hadith also from the Holy Prophet, al-nadharu ila wajhi al-alim, looking at the face of a alim is an act of worship. Looking at the face of a alim, khayrun laka min itqi alfi raqaba, it's better for you than if you were to free, if you were to emancipate 1,000 slaves. This is the virtue of a alim. This is the virtue of a knowledgeable person. And of course, especially someone who visits ulama, there is a strong emphasis on ziyaratul ulama, mujalasatul ulama, attending their gatherings, visiting them. There needs to be that level of consistency and you need to have a program. Each of one of us needs to have a program of regularly, frequently visiting ulama for whatever occasion it may be, whether it be for salatul jama'ah, whether it be if they have majlisul dhikr, whether it be if they have majlisul ilm, they have a gathering of sharing of knowledge, of conveying any kind of lesson or something like that. من أحب أن ينظر إلى عتقاء الله من النار فلينظر إلى المتعلمين. If you want to see those people who will be free and far away from entering a hellfire, then look at the muta'allimeen, look at those who are learning, look at those who are attending the majalis of ulama. And which is exactly why it says, man akrama aliman, the hadith says from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi, if you respect a alim, if you show honor to a alim, if you revere a alim, faqad akramani, then you are respecting Rasulullah. When you dignify alim, you are dignifying the Prophet. And when you are dignifying the Prophet, you are dignifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you dignify God, فَمَصِيرُهُ وَمَنْ أَكْرَمَ اللَّهِ فَمَصِيرُهُ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ, then your destination will be heaven. Imam Ali alayhi salam, he says, وَمِنْ حَقِّ الْعَالِمِ أَنْ لَا تُكْثِرْ عَلَيْهِ السُّؤَالِ وَلَا تَأْخُذْ بِثَوْبِهِ وَإِذَا دَخَلْتَ عَلَيْهِ وَعِنْدَهُ قَوْمٌ فَسَلِّمْ عَلَيْهِمْ جَمِيعًا. A lot of etiquette when it comes to ulama, you know, don't ask too much, too many questions. Try to be the listener. Absorb what you can from the alim. No, as-su'alu miftah. Many ahadiths emphasize and encourage us to ask questions. Yes, but at the same time, you need to absorb what the alim says. Listen to what the alim says. The alim is going to, of course, have a lot more to say. You know, from experience, you will be able to pick up on many things, you know, just by being a little bit patient. He will cover it, you know, in you not having to ask the question, he will cover it. And in most cases, this is exactly what will happen. And that's what it means by this particular hadith, where you need, there's that etiquette that you need to be there, which is exactly why the hadith from Imam Ali alayhi salam, he says, إِذَا جَلَسْتَ إِلَىٰ عَالِمٍ, when you are in the presence of a scholar, فَكُنْ عَلَىٰ أَن تَسْمَعْ أَحْرَصْ مِنْكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تَقُولْ, then make sure you are there, you are more adamant to listen than you are to speak or ask. Listen, absorb, gain what it is that you are able to. Maybe what you might think what he is saying is not relevant to you or not applicable or something like that. But be patient and you will see if, of course, he is that kind of a person. وَتَعَلَّمْ حُسْنَ الْإِسْتِمَاعِ, and learn how good it is, or the good way of being a listener. Being a listener. You know, many of us, you know, we just want to question and we just want to ask, we just want to critique, we just want to object, you know. In these, you know, in these ahadith, we're listening, we're hearing another side of it, even though that side is important in its own context, but this side is also very, very important as well. وَتَعَلَّمْ حُسْنَ الْإِسْتِمَاعِ كَمَا تَتَعَلَّمْ حُسْنَ الْقَوْلِ, and learn the good benefit of listening the same way as you are learning, going to learn the good way of speaking and talking as well. What about the reward of sitting with a'alim, the reward of benefiting from a'alim? Here he says, Imam Ali, he says to Abu Dharr, Ya Aba Dharr, وَالْجُلُوسُ سَاعَةً, sitting down for a while, عند مذاكرة العلم, when knowledge or علمي matters are discussed, scientific issues are discussed, أحب إلى الله, is better or more loved in the eyes of God, من قيام ألف ليلة, than 1,000 nights of worship. يصلي في كل ليلة ألف ركعة, and in each night of these 1,000 nights of worship, you are praying 1,000 rak'ahs, sitting down with the alim. And many, many ahadith that speak along these same lines. Of course, when you are talking about the qualities of alim, this alim is someone who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهُ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ, this person is مُبَلِّغْ رِسَالَاتِ رَبِّي, he is conveying the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is in the footsteps of Anbiya, he is practicing the propagation or the occupation, propagating of Islam. You know, he is conveying the message of Islam, which is the role, the responsibility, the job of al-anbiya alayhim salam. This is why the hadith says al-ulama warathatul anbiya. The ulama are the heirs of al-anbiya alayhim salam. When you look at this alim, you can see those tears in his eyes from khashyatullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what reminds you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there's many ahadith that speak about that. Now, when you know that when you are in the presence of a true alim and he is practicing what you are doing, what he is doing, what he is saying, and everything else, look at this hadith where it says from Imam Sadiq, from Imam Ali alayhi salam, كان أمير المؤمنين يقول, Imam Ali salam Allah alayhi used to say, يا طالب العلم, O seeker of knowledge, إن للعالم ثلاث علامات. A alim has three signs, three features, three qualities. العلم والحلم والصمت. علم, knowledge. Helm, forbearance, and samt, silence. Of course, silence is very, very important. Walil mutakallifi thalath alamat, which is irrelevant to this section of what we are discussing, but we can understand that, you know, the alim needs to be aware of himself. He needs to have gone through that level of tahdhibun nafs, and that level of jihadun nafs, and that level of, you know, surpassing good akhlaqi qualities, and him truly representing Islam as a religion, which is exactly why the worst thing is for a person to abuse or insult or disrespect a alim. Man ahana aliman, the hadith says from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi, man ahana faqihan musliman laqiya Allah yawm al-qiyamah wa huwa alayhi ghadban. If someone was to insult a scholar, a Muslim scholar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will be meeting Almighty God with God being wrathful against him. Man ihtaqara, Rasulullah also says, man ihtaqara sahib al-ilm faqad ihtaqarani wa man ihtaqarani fa huwa kafir. If you disrespect a bearer of knowledge, then you are disrespecting me, and if you are disrespecting me, you're not a Muslim, you are a disbeliever. And what about alim bila amal, or alim, a person of knowledge? When we say alim, automatically our mind needs to go to the positive meaning of alim. As for those who are bearers of knowledge, scientific knowledge, Imam Sadiq says, ليس العلم بكثرة التعليم والتعلم العلم نور يقذفه الله في قلب من يشاء. Nabiullah Isa, Prophet Jesus, سلام الله عليه, has said, الدينار داء الدين, that dinar, the currency, the money, is the sickness of religion. والعالم طبيب الدين, an alim is a physician of religion. فإذا رأيتم الطبيب يجر الداء إلى نفسه فاتهموه. And if you see the tabib, this alim, acquiring or, you know, attracting or bringing or pursuing this sickness of money to himself, فاتهموه. Then put a big question mark on this person. وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّهُ غَيْرُ نَاصِحٍ لِغَيْرِهِ, and know that this person is not going to be someone who can give advice to someone else. وَإِيَّاكُمْ, Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam, he says, إِيَّاكُمْ وَالْجُهَّالَ مِنَ الْمُتَعَبِّدِينَ وَالْفُجَّارَ مِنَ الْعُلَمَاءِ فَإِنَّهُمْ فِتْنَةُ كُلِّ مَفْتُونَ. Be careful, be aware, be cautious of the ignorant mutaabid, those who do ibadah out of ignorance. They just do it the ritualistic kind of way and have absolutely no understanding what they are doing. And also be careful of the corrupt ulama, because they are the source of fitna and sedition. When we look at this, we can understand from all of these sayings that the one condition for a alim is to be reluctant in any way to draw himself or herself to matters of dunya, to be someone who is avoiding, someone who stays away from any matters or any affairs of dunya. Al-fuqaha umana ur-rusul. Al-fuqaha, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he says, al-fuqaha umana ur-rusul ma lam yadkhulu fi dunya. Al-fuqaha are the trustees of the prophets, as long as they don't engage themselves in affairs of dunya. قيل يا رسول الله وما دخولهم في الدنيا. That he was asked, what do you mean by them entering into affairs of dunya? He said, اتباع السلطان, by them following the ruler, succumbing to the ruler. Of course, we're talking about the corrupt ruler, the evil ruler. فإذا فعلوا ذلك فاحذروهم على دينكم. And if they were to do that, if they were to become among those who follow the corrupt rulers, then be cautious of them in the affairs of your religion. And we all know that hadith from narrated from Imam Hassan al-Askari, attributed to Imam Hassan al-Askari. فَأَمَّا مَنْ كَانَ مِنَ الْفُقَهَاءِ صَائِنًا لِنَفْسِهِ حَافِظًا لِدِينِهِ مُطِيعًا لِأَمْرِ مَوْلَاهِ مُخَالِفًا لِهَوَاهِ فَلِلْعَوَامِ أَنْ يُقَلِّدُوهُ. Of course, and that is the kind of qualities that we need to see. حَافِظًا لِدِينِهِ مُطِيعًا لِأَمْرِ مَوْلَاهِ مُخَالِفًا لِهَوَاهِ. You know, someone who preserves their religion, someone who stays away from following their lusts and their desires. You know, صَائِنًا لِنَفْسِهِ. They've done, as I said, their tahdhibun nafs and things like that. And most importantly, they obey the commands of their Lord. Important thing that we can understand from all of this is that if you are someone who respects knowledge, then you honor and you respect and you revere the status of those who bear knowledge, those who hold knowledge, and those who practice that knowledge that they hold as well, which is, alhamdulillah, what we can see in most cases when it comes to our righteous ulama. And as for someone who is pursuing affairs of dunya, someone who does not in any way care about their akhlaqi side, someone who hasn't done any kind of disciplining of their nafs or things like that, then you need to be someone who avoids them, stays away from them. We also need to get into that habit of mujalasatul ulama, of sitting with ulama, of benefiting from ulama, and being patient in their presence as well, you know, and making sure that that's what you are going to be able to proudly contribute for yourself and also for your own well-being. You will be able to convey that knowledge to others as well, you know, with all that you are learning, and how vital it is to pick up on these kind of pieces of information that an experienced, knowledgeable person will be able to share with you, especially when they are qualified in that area and they do have that level of authority, which is also very, very important. So we shouldn't be tricked by names, we shouldn't be tricked by clothes and what it is that a person is wearing, but more in the sense of us making sure that we make the right selection, that we choose the right individual, because we are going to allow them to share with us affairs of our religion. And another hadith says, the same way as you are cautious about what you eat, you should also be cautious about who you gain your knowledge from. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala ashrafi khalqillahi Muhammad wa alihi tahireen.